Good morning, everybody. We always say, hi, it's Nick here. And I guess if you've pressed play on the video, you probably know it's Nick here because you'll have seen my name. But the vlog I'm doing today, I'm going to stand still because it's really, really muddy. We've had so much rain, so I think I'll be huffing and puffing a bit too much. But the vlog I want to do today is I want to talk about, we use the word mental health, but my own experiences. And the reason I want to do that is because I think I want to show that it's really okay to show up and own up, and it's really okay to bear all that we are to others without fear of judgment or prejudice. You know, we wouldn't hesitate if there was something physically wrong with us. And we spend so much time and energy investing in our physical health. Why don't we do the same for our mental? I think we should. And I don't think having challenges or periods of, I've had periods of quite bad depression, is in any way, shape or form a sign of weakness. I think it's just a sign of the fact that we are human, that we are all doing the very best we can to deal with circumstances as they are presented to us. Part of being human means that, you know, our brains and chemicals work in a certain way. Gosh, you know, the whole array of mental health issues is so wide. So I can only talk about my experience and how it's felt for me. And I guess that the key thing is to say, having challenges with mental health is no different in a lot of ways to physical health. There's often no rhyme or reason. You know, it doesn't worry about, you know, who you are or what your status is or any of that. My first bout was years and years ago. I was really young. I was only 20 years old. So I was a really vivacious, outgoing, very confident, very steely, I would almost say. I've often been described as a force of nature, and I think that is probably an accurate description. But, you know, I was really focused. I knew what I wanted to do in my life. I was at university. It was the summer. I was working. I took a summer job, you know, because that's what I did. I was, you know, very, I just really lived life to the full. And the thing was, I met this guy. It all came down to matters of the heart. I met this guy, and I fell madly in love. He was a lot older than me, and I think maybe he tapped into some of my vulnerabilities about status and success. You know, I'd come from my background was very rich in terms of stability. You know, loving parents, a loving family. But, you know, we weren't rich in monetary terms. And I think there was a lot of stigma associated with that. I think I'd seen that as I was growing up, the stigma associated with not having money, you know, looking at stuff. And so there must have been, I think there was definitely this thing in my head that said, you know, that's why I was so ambitious. I was so driven. And I know that would have been part of the attraction. He came from a middle class family. He'd been privately educated. He earned what I thought was a fortune. You know, you can just see the whole kind of light sparkling in my eyes. He was very charming. And it all went horribly wrong. I was due to take my year out in France as part of my degree. I haven't even been drinking, look, and I can't get my words out. Of course, it all went completely tits up. I ended up coming back from France, not doing my year out there, abandoning my studies. Moving in with him, and the whole thing went so wrong, and there was this steady decline. And now at the time, nobody really talked about depression. I had, you know, never experienced, heard the word. It just wasn't a big deal. I mean, I'm talking nearly, well, yeah, 30 years ago. I'm talking 30 years ago. This is, I remember going from being this vivacious, outgoing, you know, person to finding excuses not to go out with my friends, not to go drinking, not to go clubbing. I just couldn't stop sleeping. It was untrue. I was just so tired all the time, and I just felt so raw. I just cried, and it wasn't like a good old cry. it was something I really sobbed. It was really desperate tears. I remember it. And the guy I was with just withdrew, you know. He just, I wasn't this young, beautiful, vivacious, you know, woman with her whole career ahead of her anymore. I was this broken girl with no career ahead of her. I mean, at this point, I didn't even have a university place because I'd walked away from my year out. I only had 1 year left to do at university as well. It was all a complete pig's ear. And, you know, my family were worried about me and they took me to the doctors. But even then, you know, there was no real discussion about what was happening. They gave me some tablets, right? And they said, I must take these tablets because it would help. That is all I knew. These tablets were obviously antidepressants. I only know that in retrospect. Nobody explained to me how they would work or why I needed to take them. Counselling wasn't even mentioned. I mean, you know, the whole, when I look back, and it was a really, really difficult time. And the result of it was none of us knew what to do. None of us knew what to do. The support wasn't there, the knowledge wasn't there. I was a very, very young, frightened girl. This guy basically pissed off and left me in the end because he just couldn't cope with the fact that I was obviously, you know, depressed. I was really depressed. And I started closing down. I didn't want to talk to anybody. I didn't want to go out. I didn't want to see anybody. I just wanted to lay in bed and sleep. I just couldn't face anything. I had no hope, no joy, absolutely no life in me. And my family actually took me to stay with my auntie, who'd we had a really close relationship with my dad's brother and his wife, and his wife's just absolutely adorable, just a beautiful, cuddly, wonderful woman. And they thought that her genteelness and patience would be really good for me, and they were right, actually. So I went to stay with her. I stayed with her for about 6 months, and honestly, I mean, I'm talking, I was 20 years old. I didn't take the antidepressants because I didn't understand what they were or what I should be doing with them. I was 20 years old. I got a job at the local factory in the offices. I got up in the morning, had breakfast. I went to work for the day. I didn't really form relationships at work. I actually quite enjoyed the work. It was a really, really busy factory, and I was in the office getting the paperwork ready for deliveries and stock checks and whatever. So you just didn't have time to think. So it was a good place for me to be. And then I would go home after work. I would eat my tea, sit in the chair, and then go to bed. And I pretty much did that for 6 months. And that was a 20-year-old. And, you know, my auntie and uncle looked after me, and my family would come and see me. This guy would turn up now and again, but, you know, the whole thing was just doomed. And, I got a place. I had to move universities. It was such a mess. It was such a complete mess. And my professor was a really nice guy, and he rang a friend at another university, because you're not really meant to transfer in your final year, and said, you know, she's bright, she's just had a few issues, can she come and do a final year so she can get a degree? And I did, and there I was, you know. So I went to this new university. I went to Leeds Met University for the final year. Nobody's already established relationships. I didn't really know anybody. I had absolutely fuck all money because I'd spent all my grants, I'd spent all my student loans. You know, I was really living hand to mouth, so I couldn't really go out. And all like that final year was just about head down, get through the final exams. And to this day, I still have nightmares actually about getting my dissertation in on time and failing my degree. I still do. It's still a recurring nightmare that I have because everything hinged on it. And it was really interesting that that whole period was about a year and a half. And I would say, you know, I was still very, very vulnerable, and I still had really dark periods of sleeping, hopelessness. I can't remember ever actually feeling so bad that I wanted to end it all. But I was so confused by it all because nobody talked about depression. Nobody talked about this. And it was really only years later, I went into therapy because it left me with some really significant scars. I want to cry thinking about it now. It left me with some significant scars in terms of being able to establish relationships based on trust. Because obviously I'd been abandoned when I was at my most vulnerable. I didn't understand that whole thing at the time because, you know, we didn't talk about it. And I'm going to do this vlog on my own mental health issues in several part, so I'm going to call this part one or whatever, because otherwise, you know, I'm going to be talking for hours, because that was the first. But it was time, and I, you know, they say time heals, but if I'm honest, it didn't really heal. So what time did was it allowed me to start functioning again, and the depression, the superficial physical effects of the depression did pass. I did get my degree. It took me a long time to get over this guy. And I threw all of my energy into my career, and establishing a career and being an independent woman who wouldn't ever need to lean on a man, and indeed would spend many years avoiding at all costs falling in love with anybody, because falling in love with a man then meant, you know, this awful, I never wanted to go back to what I'd been through, fear of abandonment, of not ever letting somebody really see, look, I want to cry now, not ever really letting somebody really see all of our bits, all of our human bits, because then they might not love me, because this guy hadn't, you know, because that's what he'd shown me, was that it's really easy to love my sparkly bits. It's not so easy to love my non-sparkly bits. And that took me a long time to get over. Now, the punchline to all this, well, there's a couple. First of all, I am very happily married with three children to a man who does see all of this and has helped me get over two really difficult depression periods. So it is absolutely possible. And absolutely not only possible, but that's when love is really true love, is when you have somebody that loves all of you, not just those sparkly bits. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is that what I realized from that first bout with depression is that my wounds were never fully cleaned, and it was never really, I was never really given the right support and help to understand what was happening to me, because actually it didn't exist. We just weren't there as a society. And because those wounds weren't cleaned, I buried them. But really, there were then circumstances, particularly when I had kids, that kind of blew the top off the case that was hiding all of this stuff. And I will leave that vlog for another day, because I realise I've already been speaking for 12 minutes. So that second punchline is, my goodness, we have made so much progress. We have made so much progress in terms of how we can understand, support each other and support ourselves with mental health. And the happy note to all of this is it is something that I am hugely passionate about. We've made massive progress. We are getting much better as a society. We have a way to go, and part of this way to go is people like me getting out there and sharing our stories. And I wanted to share, I guess, the first part, my first experience with depression and what it meant for me, but also some hope that it is something that is, you know, is part of who I am. I am not ashamed of it. It is a wonderful part of my diversity. It's a wonderful part of what makes me who I am. Would I ever be able to share such love and fun and abundance if I didn't truly appreciate what that means? Because I know what it feels like to see life as hopeless. You know, there's the real paradox in there. And so, yeah, that's the first part of my journey in terms of really owning my story and sharing it. And yeah, another day, another time, I will share the next. And what got me through that? Just the love and care of a family, even though none of us knew what to do, just having that love and care, that was that stability that was there, you know, eventually got me through. So I'm sending lots of love to everybody. I know we're all living in really difficult times right now, really difficult times. And if, you know, we're finding it challenging, then I think it's perfectly reasonable that we're finding it challenging, because it is challenging. And it's okay to say that, and it's okay to reach out, and it's okay to talk about it. And it's okay to own your story. So until next time, take care. Bye.